You can't hear anything?
La 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 la.
That's really weird.
Nothing. What, the noise we just made, or?
There you go.
La 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 la. How are we doing?
Gotta be careful.
Look, Doug's here. He's fine.
That's true. Right.
And you know, don't let that intense look scary.
Yeah,
you're intimidating. He's got a big heart inside there. I know you do. I know. You can't hide it from
I'm me. Going to take it out during this interview.
Your bare hands.
Yes. Yes. You want, when Spiel tell you a big heart, at some point you want to like probably go see a doctor about it.
Yeah.
It could be a dangerous thing.
You know what would be nice is for, I feel like you didn't get to really hang out.
No.
You didn't even really get a party after the screening in Toronto. We never had that thing where we'd like sit around and have dinner together.
And wind down from it all, yeah. Well, you missed a couple of dinners early on because Guillermo was keeping you away from us, right? Because we had a couple of cast dinners that we didn't see you.
Yeah.
I think he wanted to keep you know, the mysterious...
The mysterious Michael Shannon.
Antagonist.
Yeah, exactly. So basic idea, this is a chat. Michael's suffered through this a number of times. You're new to this, but I thought it would be kind of fun to have the two of you together.
The adversaries.
Huh?
The adversaries.
The adversaries. Yeah. You guys are actually almost the same height.
Mm. Yeah.
Michael's a little bit bigger, but you guys
a little bit. I think he works out.
It's a secret.
When Michael's in a suit, it's much bigger.
Yes, exactly.
Than your suit. Yours is like skin tight.
Well, I'm not a god.
Well, yeah.
Well, you were, weren't you? You were a demigod, I guess.
What? Who?
In Zod? Superman.
Oh, well, Zod. No, he's just a general.
He just rhymes with God.
Yeah.
He's just a general. Yeah. From another planet, though.
Yeah.
And you can fly.
That would be interesting. Zod versus the creature.
The creature.
Anything we're
I don't know. Who would win? I have supernatural powers. Remember, I can make bullet wounds go away. Right. I can swipe you across the neck if I want.
Right.
You know.
Well, yeah, that's how Superman gets rid of me, right? I mean, he cracks my neck. Yeah. I've got my neck cracked and my neck sliced.
Seems like a long time ago, isn't it?
Something about that neck. We all want a piece of that.
Get rid of that neck.
People just want to kill Michael Shannon. That's
exactly.
The goal.
And so then they call me mean.
You're right.
Why
are
you always so mean? Why is everybody always killing me?
You'd be mean too. Exactly.
You're just
I always like to remind people of this movie. It's like, you do realize our relationship starts off with him biting off my fingers. Everybody remembers that, right?
Yeah, but hey, you deserved it, probably. Now, we didn't see what went on in that room, but I think you were taunting me as usual.
Well, mister. I think the time is now to... This is like our therapy session.
This is like our couples therapy?
Yeah, yeah.
We're working through our issues.
Strickland and the creature.
Yeah, he never understood me. He didn't listen.
He never bought me candy. I knew I liked it.
I'm from the Amazon. I don't know. What's candy?
Yeah, right.
I can bring you some kelp, maybe. I don't know.
No, he's not into vegetables.
You don't think that's true? He's more of a meat eater.
Yeah,
that's true.
Meat and candy.
That's right. Yeah. Your hard candy and some dead animals.
Yeah.
When you guys actually do have extremely different sex lives in the movie.
Oh, yes. 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 Mine is tender and loving. I'm not so sure about his.
That's, you know, I mean, it takes all kinds, you know.
Mm.
I mean, you can't all be warm and sensitive.
You don't get to get a lot of sex lives in your movies as a rule, do you?
I don't remember a whole lot of sex on screen.
Yeah?
I've had sex with Kim Basinger.
Well, that's
on a couch.
How'd that go? I don't remember
that.
She
was very nice. Oh, so you never saw 8 Mile?
Oh, I did see 8 Mile. It's just so long ago, I've become
adult-minded.
Too many other movies.
Since then.
Yes.
Too many Negronis.
I actually saw that at Toronto in the Elgin. It premiered there.
When did you?
The 8 Mile did?
Yeah. It was like a big deal, but it wasn't finished. That was what Universal kept on saying because they didn't want reviews.
Sneaky.
But they had, you know, 700 people watching it.
Right.
And Eminem came and...
And they did all right.
Yeah, they did really well.
And I think the reviews... I think you couldn't have stopped people from going to see that movie. You could have gotten a review like, this is like getting your eyes scratched out with a fork. There still would have been a line around the block.
Right.
Yeah.
So those movies are often like tricky. So it actually, I think actually the box office is impressive.
I think for dirty little secret, I don't typically like musical biopics, but I thought 8 Mile was actually, because I feel like they're so repetitive, like they're all the same story. Mm-hmm. They're just putting like different actors in there. Like the difference between Ray and Walk the Line is, you know, Jamie Foxx and Joaquin Phoenix, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But it's like the same story.
Right.
But with 8 Mile, I feel like it was a very, they really captured the details. But we're not here to talk about 8 Mile.
It was great, though. It was great.
So, how when you now see I'm fascinated. How early was how many films had you done when you did 8 Mile?
Oh Jesus, I don't know.
That's pretty early in the run, no?
Well, I got my SAG card on Groundhog Day.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
That was probably 10 years before 8 Mile.
That's true. Did they didn't ask you to do the musical?
The musical of Groundhog Day?
Yeah.
You're funny. You know, you do realize I'm in Groundhog Day for perhaps 2 minutes.
But they could have pupped up the part, as they do when they, you know.
They could. I don't think anybody needs to see me in a musical on Broadway.
No, you're not a singer, dancer?
Not your thing?
When I sing, I like to scream.
Ah. So you want to do Rent?
Yeah,
screaming. Or maybe like Rent? There's a lot of screaming in Rent, I always feel like.
Yeah. Well, don't bring up Rent. Because then I think of Anthony Rapp, and then I think of Kevin Spacey, and there's...
It's a whole other conversation.
That's a dark hole. It's a different interview, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. We've all been avoiding those interviews or having them. Yeah. Jessica Chastain, I talked last week, and we did about 3 minutes on the movie and about 25 minutes on all of that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She's very intuit.
Oh, I bet. Yeah.
Pretty serious. So do you dance?
I started as a mime, actually, that whole thing, that annoying art form that where you follow somebody around the park and act like them.
Yeah. But get beat up by guys like Michael.
Get by guys like this, yeah. But, so movement are us, yes. The art form of mime did kind of wake my body up to all the visual and physical communication that happens non-verbally, sure.
So how early did that become your thing?
College, back at Ball State University in Indiana.
You went to Ball State?
I did.
I have a friend that teaches at Ball State.
Yeah.
Small world.
Well, yeah. I graduated in 82, though, so it's been a long time. Yeah.
Muncie.
Muncie, Indiana.
What a name for a town.
Muncie. What's a Muncie? I don't know.
It's kind of Polish for the middle of America. I guess that makes sense, actually.
Yeah.
I was like Sepulveda here, which, like, we're in a Spanish
Sepulveda,
town.
I like Sepulveda, though. That's
but it shouldn't be Sepulveda. It's a town of Spanish things.
Yeah,
you're going to
do it right, I guess.
Doesn't La Cienega mean the swamp?
And fitting it is.
Yeah.
I live in La Cienega.
Yeah.
That's not that big of a thing.
I think, am I right?
I think you're right, yes.
Yeah. I looked it up once.
Well, like Boca Raton is the mouth of the rat.
Is it really?
Yes.
Wow.
And where people go to.
Sounds so exotic when you don't know what it means.
Yes,
right?
It does. So you were you lanky and all of that when you were when you were a little kid?
I look the same way now as I did as a 16-year-old. Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And so were you awkward, or did you find a way to not be awkward?
Was I awkward? Oh my gosh, I was the epitome of awkward, yeah. So feeling like a monster every day, like I didn't fit in, yes, that's why I could channel this role in this movie so well. I was like, yeah, I know what it's like to be the monster who doesn't fit in. Mm. But what I find though is that during those teenage years, we kind of all felt out of sorts with ourselves. It's a very fear-based time of life, I think, you know?
Yeah, I think it's more uncommon to hear someone say, I really loved going to high school.
Yeah, right.
It was awesome.
Puberty was great.
I had it together every day. I was confident. You don't hear hardly anybody say that.
No, I'm just curious about the transition in finding a physical art form as a way of expressing yourself.
Yeah. Well, I didn't seek it out. The mime thing came about when I was in college because when I was a freshman, a senior that lived in my dorm was the head of the mime troupe called Mime Over Matter. So he approached me and said, you know, the way you talk with your hands all the time and you're being long and lanky, you're kind of built for this mime art form, and we're doing a show, come watch it and tell me what you think. So I did, loved it, and I auditioned for the troupe, and that's how I started as a mime, by accident, yeah.
And did you ever actually have a physical confrontation with Bill Irwin to see who could be supreme?
Confrontation? No, it never came to fisticuffs. We were in the same movie, though, Lady in the Water, a long time ago. I was one of the Tartudics that jumped out of the trees at the end of the movie, but we didn't really have FaceTime with each other. Yeah.
In real life, you mean? They would never bounce off each other?
Yeah, no.
Because it would seem like you guys kind of work that same track a bit.
Yeah, no, I really respect his work. I think Bill Irwin is super entertaining and gifted, yeah.
Mr. Noodles.
Mr. Noodles.
Yeah.
So in a movie like this, when you're in the suit, you're not in the suit, you have scenes.
I'm wearing a suit.
Well, you're wearing
tie.
That's
yeah,
true. You are wearing clothes.
A lot of work
went
into those suits.
No, you
really?
Didn't.
I had a lot of fittings.
Because they had to be just so.
Oh, or? Lewis, our costume designer, was like, this suit is going to fit you microscopically.
Yeah.
Like measurements I didn't even know existed.
And was that good or bad for you?
I loved it. I was saying to someone else that it kind of got me in the mood for the part because I think that's what Strickland's like. He wants his suit to fit exactly, and yet he feels like it never does.
Yeah. Yeah. Your whole life seemed tailored, didn't
it? Yeah, yeah.
The car, the wife, the...
Tailored and yet phenomenally uncomfortable at the same time.
Exactly, yeah.
And ready to explode at any moment, it feels
like.
Yeah,
yeah.
So when you guys work together, is it like working together in a normal scene?
Oh gosh, no, I didn't think so. Did you? you were beating a fish man.
You know, honestly, between the takes, I was just always concerned about you. And not really... because of anything I was doing, because I don't feel like, I think I can say with some confidence that I never actually hurt
me. No, we rehearsed all that, and what are the good spots to hit and bad? You know, you were very good about all
but
that.
But he was on his knees on that, he called it the plinth,
that
cement
concrete
block. Slab. and he had to get chained in, so sometimes Guillermo would ask him to stay down as long as he could possibly stand it in order to save time.
We ended up putting little gel pads under my knees because I'm very bony all over, so my bony knees in a concrete slab. And we were a few days. We didn't get that scene all done in one day. So it was a lot. And that was early on. That was like one of my first scenes in the whole movie that I did.
Yeah.
So.
But do you make contact when you're is there the contact the two actors make in a scene possible when you're in that suit?
Yeah,
more than you would think, right? Yeah. We connected and had a very antagonistic sort of vibe going for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I could tell that your character did not like mine, didn't want me around. I could tell that, and I don't know if you could tell, but I didn't like you being around either. It's like I was the hissing cat when he came back in the room, like, oh, him again.
Yeah.
Is it interesting? I mean, could you've done suit work with Guillermo before?
Mm-hmm.
But you got to talk, even though you got dubbed, I think.
I've done verbal and nonverbal, characters for Guillermo. Now, this is my sixth movie with him. Now the last time I played a fish man for him was in the Hellboy movies, and that was, but he was a very gentlemanly, very gestury, flourishy, intelligent, well-spoken, huge vocabularied gentleman. This was an animal from the wild, so there was a distinct difference. And I was sentient and intelligent in this movie, but also I had to learn communication because I'd never really been face-to-face with humans before. In the Amazon, they kind of like worshiped me as a god, but let me be, And here, it's very different. It's like I'm being tested and torn apart piece by piece and biopsied and misunderstood, mostly. And that was all new and different and discombobulating.
So is the idea that they saw him as a god in the Amazon part of his consciousness?
I don't think he thinks about it every day. He just he was born into whatever he is, and he is that thing. Even though I'm being tortured by this authority figure, and being very much put in my place, like with his authoritative ways. I never lost my confidence. I mean, I very much had a very distinct sense of my being the entire time. And as the movie plays out, you'll see why, I had a mission to complete, and I did that.
So do you is there things you studied that are different for this in terms of the physicality or the manifestations?
You're playing a bit of an animal. You can distinctly study fish if you want to go look at fish and how they move and how all that, which is fine. The difference for this one was that I'm the romantic leading man of the movie, right? And so that was what made this monster a bit different than the others I've played before. Mm-hmm. You know, was I had to fall in love on film with a human being, and she had to fall in love with me, and we had to do it in a way that the audience would buy it, and they would fall in love with both of us as well. So that presented the challenge right there.
So what was the most challenging part of that?
Was doing it as an animal from the wild, without being able to, I had to fight my human instincts the entire time. You know, when being talked to or reacting to a human being in this story, fighting the urge to nod my head or to tilt my head or to reach out or gesture in some way like, gotcha, as a human would do.
Right.
I had to fight that instinct and find really what the family dog would do. When you're talking to Fluffy, it's like, hey, you did a good boy. How does the dog respond? The dog does not go, yeah, thanks, Dad. You know, the dog has
I've long suspected I was a good boy.
I was a good boy. right. So the dog has his own ecosystem. He might tilt his head out of curiosity. He might wag his tail. He might, you know, run in circles and bark. That's an ecosystem that's not human. So I had to find what that was for, you know, for this fish man. So
you just take the script and go and do that like an actor would do the back work with everything else?
Basically, yeah.
Figure out that language for yourself?
And also conferencing with Guillermo del Toro, our director, who had some specific ideas. His direction on set with me was rather shorthanded. If I was doing something a bit too human in a moment, he would just say, doggy, ha! That was enough. I got it, animal, got it. And so I instead of giving an audible roar, I kind of did an inhale because I'm a fish out of water, basically. So I would kind of give it more of a and that was kind of like how I started to communicate was with that and give me something.
So did Gamero have a shorthand for you?
Jesus, no. No, we didn't really, I don't know.
Did he show you, were there movies he showed you as a guidepost, or do you just know noir enough to go there?
Yeah, there was nothing he insisted that I watch or anything. I honestly think he just wanted me to, for lack of a better word, do my thing, you know? I don't know, he didn't. I can't remember much him trying to get me to do something one way or the other. I mean, that's the thing, is he wrote it with me in mind, and he wanted me to be me, I guess.
Well, that's the beauty of Guillermo del Toro, I think, in general. He hires actors, and he's a great actor's director because he loves what you're bringing to the table, whatever that is. And he does, and if the soup doesn't taste off, he will not add any more spice to it. It's perfect as it is.
Just leave it be. Right.
So this soup is delicious. So you kind of let it go.
I mean, I'm really obsessive. I think I oftentimes ask him for takes, even though he was ready to move on, and he was very gracious to give them to me because I just loved all the doing those scenes so much. I was always sad when they were
over.
Most of them. I wasn't sad when the scene where I beat you up was over.
Yeah, right.
Because that went on forever.
Yeah, it was a tough one to take. Get
that was
done.
It's just a big sequence. I mean, it's weird. It kind of flies by in the movie, but man, it took a look. And there were so many setups on that scene. Right. So much coverage, so many different characters, and then you've got Hofstetler tracking Liza and
yeah. A lot going on. And then the general comes into the room with his posse and so there are many beats to that scene. Yeah.
But I love doing all my scenes up in the office. My scenes with Stuhlbarg, my scenes with Sally.
Oh god. Yeah.
The scene where I'm looking at everybody's time cards. The scene with the general. I love doing all that stuff up in my office.
So what is it about Sally?
About Sally?
Yeah, is she just as ethereal as she feels on screen?
I think so. I think she's sprinkled with pixie dust. I think she's something from another world. She has an element of magic to her. I love working with her. Yeah.
She's very, it's not really an act, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't mean to diminish, like, oh, it takes no work or anything.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, of course it takes work. It's very hard. They were long days, but I just feel like she's incapable of screwing it up.
Or faking it.
Yeah, and she's so hard on herself.
God, yes.
Like, we finished the scene, she'd be like, oh, you were so wonderful, and I was so rubbish. And I was like, no, you actually were really great. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
She's like, I wish I had another opportunity. Just maybe a week from now, if we could do it again. And I was like,
no, that was every day, every scene with me, too.
Yeah.
She would, and I just watched something perfect happen.
Right,
and she
right.
was so dissatisfied with herself.
Yeah,
maybe that's what made that
the nightmare of being an actor.
Well, she seems like, so at peace.
Yeah.
So the fact that she's churning inside is fascinating.
You got your, I think we all felt like a mandate to do our absolute best work because of Guillermo.
Yes.
His passion, knowing that this movie, and that I think he loves all of his movies, but that this movie had a special place in his heart.
This movie seems like more of a personal passion project for him than others I've been in with him too, yeah.
So we all wanted to honor that. Mm-hmm. So, but it was also, it's just fun. It's fun to do this movie, despite some of the darker aspects of it sometimes. It's just, it's fun. It's a fun script to work on. Fun. Yeah.
It's also pretty unusual to see a picture that goes that's in this genre that is not a green screen or blue screen thing where everything's on set and you're doing period and you're doing all those things and yet he's just capturing them in camera.
Yeah,
it's kind of great.
It would have been a disservice to the audience and to the actors on set to have a tennis ball on a stick. You know, if you have a monster, it's best to have it there in person in pub, and because he had something to actually hate in front of him.
Yeah.
And even the sets,
they're amazing. You know,
fantastical. Yeah.
It's a beautiful world that they built in Toronto.
Palette, the art design, all of it.
So what was the like? Is it a surprise when you walk on a set like that for the first time?
Hmm. Yeah, it was. When I did Man of Steel, they had some spaceships and outer space stuff, planets and whatnot, and they would kind of half build a set and then half green screen.
Hmm.
There'd be elements like a big black rock here or something. So, but I'll never forget, once I had the scene where I was supposed to be looking out the window of the spaceship at my planet exploding and realizing that my home is gone forever.
Mm-hmm.
A planet.
Mm-hmm.
I'm standing there with Ancha, who played my sidekick. And I was just literally looking at a piece of orange tape.
How do you imagine all of this, right?
How much are they paying? That's supposed to be. Think about it. It'd be like looking at Earth and watching it blow up.
That's kind of huge.
I know there's nothing they can do about it.
No,
So you're always very grateful. And the sets, the color scheme was so beautiful.
Very aquatic, very water-like.
It's like you wish it should be like a theme park. People should be able to come and visit it. They should have in Toronto. I mean, they got Universal and whatever, because they built quite a few stages in that. Where is it? I don't even know what it's called. Guillermo's. It's like his studio.
Oh, it's in the space up in Toronto. This is where we filmed.
Guillermo's world.
Guillermo's world.
Yeah, I think that helped with the budget he was talking about the other day with the Strain TV show that's his. We use the same studios, same art, costume designers and art directors. He had a lot of the same staff, so it helped keep the budget down, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
So,
because this is he didn't have a lot of money to make this.
$19.5 million, I think, and that's.
For a movie like this.
That's a lot of money in my pocket, but it's not much to make a movie,
Sure.
So.
It's a funny business that way. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But Mike gets $19 million paydays every week, so.
You're right.
Every movie is at your asking price right now, isn't
very
it?
Very acutely observed.
I get $19.5. That's what I get. Mm-hmm.
Slightly different checks. I assume you've both done the Guillermo tour, the Guillermo's World.
The house?
The house. Yeah. You probably did it at the house. Have you done it at the house?
I've never been to Bleak House, which is remarkable because I'm in the Bleak House a lot. There's a lot of me over. No, but I went to the exhibit at LACMA here in LA of his, what's it called? It's At Home with Monsters. That's the name of the exhibit, right?
And I think it's in Toronto now.
I have the coffee table book.
Okay. There you go.
I didn't know there was a coffee
there
table
is.
Book.
There is.
I had to get that.
You gave it to me. So, but I haven't been to Bleak House either.
Yeah.
I want to go.
Quite a collection of artwork from his own movies and from other movies and artists that he dislikes, sculptures and paintings and just a ton of, no wonder it's on display and touring the world.
Right.
It's an insight into the man.
Yeah,
it is.
So when you see this all put together, does it pretty much what you expected? I mean, it seems like the way he did it, it would all just make sense.
Well, yeah, he's so prepared. He spent so much time thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And yet I did notice with the third act that it was, he kind of streamlined it towards the end. Mm-hmm. Like, there were a lot more kind of, how shall we say, perhaps set pieces or whatever, a little more violence that got taken out. And it makes sense because I think he may have thought it was a bit hysterical when he looked at it all together. Maybe he just wanted it to get to the ending a little quicker.
No, I was told that also that I think there were maybe 40 minutes cut out of the original mm-hmm. edit. Yeah. So got it down to 2 hours. So it was much longer to start with Sue. So maybe that's
well. Sometimes it can be all that the extra violence can be distracting from the core idea.
Yeah,
You know, distract from the love.
Yeah.
And it's all about love.
And it's all about love, this one, yeah.
And how much water was there? I mean, it was all that water that we see in different places in the movie,
No. Yes and no. We did both. We shot, I was in water, and I was also shooting dry for wet sometimes. The laboratory where I'm being tested, there was a cylinder, sort of glass cylinder that I was in, that was dry. I was in there with some smoke and lighting effects, and I was on a teeter-totter to get the up and down floaty effect, and all supported on my little bony butt, and acting like I'm floating in water. And then the pool that was in there that I was chained to the wall, and that was actual water, of course, that I would come up out of or dive back into, and so I was wet all the time in a rubber suit that absorbed it all like a sponge. So I weighed 300 pounds when I got out of the water. Oh my gosh!
Oh, man.
Isn't that a little dangerous?
It might be. I don't know, but I had help. I had people.
Okay.
And then the scene in the bathroom, though, where Sally and I are now in the middle of our love story, and one more time we're going to have at it with each other in a loving way.
Unlike Mike and his wife.
Unlike this one, who just goes at it with violence and satisfy me, woman.
She's the one who taught me how to do it.
Actually.
That's right. She was rather come hither, wasn't she?
Yeah. Right. It's her idea.
Close to dominatrix, I would say.
But the bathroom, that bathroom scene, they built the same bathroom set in a tank that was so it was actually filled up with real water, about 8 feet of it. So we would gather our air at the top and then plunge down for the start of for the action cue, and then the final scene of the movie too, where we're floating and the camera's backing up from us. Mm-hmm. That was a really wide shot. We were suspended by wires from hip harnesses in the middle of a sound stage with more smoke and more lighting effect.
Oh, when you're in the water?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. No,
we were not really in water. He had some fans going to get some ripples on clothing and to get her hair going. And then, of course, some CG After Effects, too, that helped the whole process look like we were underwater.
But, so what's it like acting in all of that?
Challenges. I've become, personally, in a makeup and costume like that, I become a nursing home patient. I can't see very well, I can't hear very well, I can't walk very well. And yet on film, I have to play as though I'm a little bit more than human with my abilities and my strengths. So, but in reality, I had to have help walking to the set. So, there's a challenge there. That's all. Yeah.
So, has this run of movies been what you aspired to as an artist? As a
no.
And you were in college, and
no. When I was in college, I thought I was going to be a goofy sitcom star. Because I mean, look at me.
I'm still time.
Still time. But I'm a not being a handsome leading man type. I have to be funny or scary, and I was seeking to be like a goofy sidekick on a sitcom. I thought that's where I belong. And I did not know that playing creatures and monsters and creepy crawly things under heavy rubber makeups was a career option. until it was presented to me by either.
They don't have that course in your college.
No, they did not.
That major.
So this wacky career I ended up with kind of ended up finding me, and I didn't seek it out ever. But I'm tickled pink that somebody wanted to hire me for anything really.
So being so much a part of Guillermo's world, is that particularly satisfying? Is it
Gosh, yeah, no, he's very loyal to he builds a family around him, and if he likes working with you and likes the rapport, he'll have you back again. But he doesn't do you any favors just because he likes you. You have to deliver something, or he won't have you back in another movie again. So when he calls up and says, "I have a part for you in a film," it's a compliment in the highest order. It really is.
So you've seen him come, you've seen him go.
Yeah, well, I've known him for 20 years. We met on Mimic back in 1997, and he's been calling me ever since. So I owe the man a lot. He changed my life.
You survived his least happy experience as a filmmaker.
Oh, he didn't like that one.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the big HW, I think.
Yeah, he's not too shy about that, talking about that one.
Yeah, but I think he ended up getting his own edit, his own cut, finally. He got a director's cut of that. That was a bit more satisfying.
I think there are at least four or five cuts of that movie
floating around somewhere or another.
And how are you doing, Michael? Are you satisfied? Are you happily floating through your amazing career?
Yeah, sure. It's great. I mean... I don't know. I just trying to make all my appointments and not be on time. It's my dance card's a little overstuffed sometimes. Mm-hmm. But it's just because I have I'm fortunate that people like Guillermo and other people feel strongly about me being involved in some fashion. So I have these two beautiful kids that I wish I spent more time with, but I get home on the weekends,
And is life as a movie star the same thing you were expecting
I'm not
when
a
you
movie
were
star.
You don't think you're a movie star?
No, I'm not a movie star.
I don't know.
Really?
So who is anybody in this movie a movie star? Is Octavia qualify yet?
She's probably the biggest star out of all of us, Octavia.
Yeah. You guys kind of are parallel track kind of careers at this point, I think.
Everybody's a movie star, but none of us want to say so, I don't think. Because right? that implies...
Jenkins isn't a movie star, but he's a diva.
That guy. What a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
A difficult man.
But anyway, to answer your question, when I was a little kid, the irony of it is when I was a little kid, the last thing I ever thought in my wildest dreams I would ever become would be an actor. I didn't
really.
Yeah, when I was a little boy, I thought I was like, well, maybe I'll be an architect or. I started playing music before I was acting. I was played in orchestra, piano, and stuff like that. But yeah, is strange to I guess see the other side of the red velvet rope. It's funny how I guess the big thing most people realize is like, oh, they're all just people too. It's just a bunch of people.
But you do keep on putting out two or three movies a year really that get this kind of attention.
I don't know, I could hit a dry spell at any moment. There's no telling. There's no telling. But, I also like doing theater and, strumming and the guitar and things like that. I don't always have to be in the spotlight.
Well, you seem to not want to be in the spotlight all the time, and yet it finds you.
Well, I don't know. I think mostly what I have next year is the TV stuff. Mm-hmm. We got that Waco TV show on Fahrenheit 451. That's on TV. Mm-hmm. I might have a movie, a little movie.
Yeah.
You need more work. That's
yeah,
the problem.
Yeah,
that's it, yeah. And I'm living in TV land too with Star Trek Discovery going. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we got picked up for season two. Very excited about that.
Oh, great.
But I'm under rubber again, so I can still go to Starbucks and nobody knows who I am, which is great.
Unless you wear rubber.
Unless I wear rubber mitts.
That's a whole nother. We're back to Harvey Weinstein again. It's, thank you, gentlemen.
No,
appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Hey. Yes.